tonight with the series Staying Positive in a Negative World. And tonight we have with us Brother Roger Rodriguez. Amen. Let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. How's everybody doing tonight? Have we got any excited folk in the house tonight? Huh? Anyone that came ready, hungry, wanting for to hear from God tonight? Huh? Is there any hungry folk in the house? Sound like one or two. It sounds like there's one or two that you know, that they really want it. How many really, really want it? There got to be some folk that really want it. You want it, you got to draw it out. Come on. Show me you want it. Come on. Give them a praise like never before. Come on. Let's give them a moment. Come on. Let's give them some glory. Come on. Let's give them some glory, I said. Come on, let's give them some glory tonight. Some of you guys need to shake it up. Come on, you need to shake it off tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, lift them up. Come on. Yes, hallelujah. I thank you, Father. Hallelujah for what you're getting ready to do, Lord God. We take charge over this atmosphere tonight. Father, we release you in the house tonight, Lord God. I pray that tonight, Lord God, will be a night, Lord God, of jubilee, Lord God. A night, Lord God, like never before, oh God, in my life, oh God. I release, Lord God, I release everything you have tonight, Lord God, over this night, Lord God. Everything you had intended, every plan, Lord God, every word that you wrote on the tabernacles of my heart, Lord God. Lord, let me be a cocoon tonight, Lord God. Let me just empty myself of myself, Lord God, that you may fill me tonight, Lord God, with your Shekinah glory, oh God. Father, we're in times, Lord God, that are pestilent times, oh God. We're in times that, Lord God, the world is shaking, Lord God. But I want the people of God to know, hallelujah, that in the house of God, hallelujah, yeah, there is no worry, hallelujah, there's no lack, hallelujah, there's nothing, hallelujah, that can separate you from the love of God. How many love God tonight? Oh, hallelujah. Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you that in the midst of the storm, Lord God, that you want to answer our prayers tonight, Lord God. Tonight's word is about answering our prayers. Hallelujah. I thank you, Lord God, that in these days, Lord God, we can lift up a standard, Lord God, in our homes, in our families, in our jobs, Lord God, wherever we may be, that we may spread the love of God. Oh, hallelujah. I charge this atmosphere, Lord God. I ask you, Lord God, come have your way tonight, Lord God. Reign in this place, Lord God. Let someone get so hungry tonight, Lord God, that they be like that woman, Lord God, that ran after you, Lord God, that knew, Lord God, if there was just one touch, oh God, it would change her life forever. And I know that we have some hungry folk in this house, oh God. I know that we got some folk, Lord God, that need a touch tonight, Lord God. We have a folk tonight, Lord God, that need to take charge over their lives tonight, oh God. And Father, as we seek you out in this area, Lord God, of being able, Lord God, to understand that you want to answer our prayers, oh God, that we're limited by the way we ask for things from you, Lord God. I want to take off the limitations tonight, oh God. I want to remove anything that can stop your people from asking over and over and over and over again, Lord God. Lord, I need you in my life. I'm in a time of turbulence. I'm in a time of, Lord God, of need. I'm in a time of lack. I know there's a lot of people that are staying up at night asking God just for his miracle working power to move in their lives. And I pray that tonight, Lord God, we be that night, Lord God, that you will let them know, Lord God, you've been carrying them through the storm, oh God, through the storms of life, oh God, through those things that are the very worries, oh God. Let them know that those are footsteps, oh God. Oh, hallelujah. Let them use them as footsteps, Lord God. And understand that, hallelujah, you're carrying them to a higher place. You're carrying them to a higher standard. You're taking them to places they haven't been in a long time because they're too scared to ask for it, oh God. Let him that have an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying tonight. It's time that we take charge of our lives, brothers and sisters. It's time that we start to understand that, you know what, we have not because we ask not. It's time to let the Lord know what it is you're going through and trust in him and lay it at his feet and know that his will shall be done in your life. You can't be the driver and the pilot and the passenger and everybody in the vehicle at one time. It's time to let go, guys. I come to tell you tonight, it's time to let go and let God. It's time to allow God to be the driver of your life. It's time to let God take over your situation. It's time to let it go and hang it up and leave it there in the closet. It's time to get up in the morning and wake up and say, you know what? I take authority over this day. I rebuke you, devil. I rebuke you, devil. You're under my feet. You're too worried about your cup of coffee and your piece of cake and your pastry. You're too worried about your pancakes and your bacon and your eggs. You know, it sounds funny, but you know what? That's what takes up your time in the morning, your thoughts about what you're going to eat to start your day. Instead of eating the Word of God and standing on the Word of God and proclaiming some stuff over your life, over your children, over your family, over your job. You want answered prayer, but you want to sit back and eat your pancakes and have it too. Do we want a blessing or do we want a mixed blessing? What do you want? Look, you got to make up your mind. We're in a microwave, a time of a microwave mentality. We want to be able to just cut up and just, you know, let the Lord do what he does. I know I serve a God who can. I know I serve a God that's going to take care of every one of my needs. But you don't do nothing so that your needs will be met. What kind of message do you want every week? You want one that makes you feel good? Or you want one that makes you wake up and understand that, you know what, we need a reality check sometimes. Sometimes it can't be all peaches and cream like everybody wants it when they come to church. Somebody got to wake up and stand up and say, you know what, it's time to smell the coffee. And the coffee smells rotten. You know why? Because you're jumping right to the coffee and you're not going to the one that gives you the bean, the one that makes it smell good, the one that's the incense of life. Come on. The Lord's been sending you word after word after word after word after word. What are you doing with the word? What are you doing with the blessings? What are you doing with all these times that all these men and women of God are standing before you every week, week in, week out, telling you that the Lord is coming? Hallelujah. It's time to take the word and work the word. You want answered prayer? Start asking. Start trusting. I challenge you tonight to take a moment and go before God for one thing. Ask him for one thing and start praying about it day and night and night and day until you see the hand of God move in your life. And then you're going to understand that you were walking with the blessing all the time. Amen. All the time. While you all stressed out and you're all worried about the things of life that's going on, the blessing's been with you all the time. You never exercise the right to be able to speak those things that be not as though they are. Yeah. It's time that we do that. It's time that we take charge in the church, that we take charge in the families. I remember when I used to, when I grew up, I remember what it was to see a praying mom and a praying dad. I know what it was to see people on bended knee. And society is going to hell in high water. Why? Because nobody wants to get on bended knee anymore. It doesn't mean nothing. Society has changed people so much that people are not on bended knee anymore. You may be seated. A lot of the problems in your life is because you're listening to the media. You're listening to the things that are to come, and you're worried about the physical things, not understanding that the spiritual things overtake everything of the natural. All the stuff that's going to happen in life is going to happen. But you know what? When you stand up and pray, when you take charge, when you start to speak to the atmosphere, when you start speaking to your day, I'm telling you, your destiny is going to change. Your faith is going to change. Your walk is going to change. Your talk is going to change. Your children are going to change. I work in a place, I've said it before, with 12 people. And out of the 12 people, when I first came there, not one of them would ever take a moment to lift up God in prayer. And you know what? I started with one, and then before one, the light started to shine, and then two came, and then three came, and then four came, and then five came, and then six came, and then seven came, and then eight came. And right now I'm up to 9 out of 12. You know why? Because I speak to those things. I've been a million-dollar writer for 9 years in a row. You know why? Because I speak to the blessing. I speak to everything in my life. I pray every day. I ask God every day for his provision, for his covering. I pray that God will cover my children, that God will cover my children's children, that God will cover my wife, that God will bless me, that God will use me wherever I be. I ask the Lord, you know, Lord, give me someone in my past today that I can speak to, that I can minister to, because I know you're a God that answers prayers. And let me tell you, brothers and sisters, there's so many people in need of prayer today. So many people. I remember when I used to go to work and nobody wanted to pray. Nobody wanted to lift up God. But you know what? Those people used to come to me when they had a problem and they say, hey, Brother Roger, can you pray for me? Can you pray for my wife? Can you pray for my child that's sick? I'm telling you, he's a God that answers prayers, brothers and sisters. Start to petition for the things in life. God wants you to be prosperous. God wants you to be blessed. But if you don't speak the blessing over your life, how do you expect it ever to come? It just comes out of nowhere, shabam, I'm rich. No. It takes you taking the time to start speaking to the atmosphere. Lord, I thank you where you have me right now, Lord God. I thank you that I'm blessed, Lord God. I thank you that I have a paycheck right now, Lord God. I thank you for the clothes. I thank you for the food. I thank you for your only begotten son, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. But we've forgotten this. We've forgotten this, brothers and sisters. We've allowed the things of the world to infiltrate us so much that you do not spend enough time thanking God for what you have. All you do is complain about what you don't have. And then you know what's the real, real crazy thing about it all? That if I bet you if you went into your closet, if you went into your drawers, and you started to pull everything out that you have there, 50% of the things you have, you never even use it. You never even use it. And you're asking for more. Why don't you go through your things and take that 50% and give it to a person that don't have it, that would appreciate it? Amen. We need to change the way we're doing business, brothers and sisters in the church. We need to start interceding. We need to start lifting one another up. We need to start praying for one another. We need to start calling on one another. We need to start to be more tentative when things are going on with each other. We got to stop one being in that corner and one being in that corner, and this one don't talk to that one, and that one don't talk to this one. Come on. We're a family in Christ. We're all here. You know what? No, somebody raise your hand that's perfect in the house. One of you, come on. I know there got to be one in the house. One of you raise your hand. If you're perfect, do it right now, right here, right now. I want the perfect one to raise up their hand. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? If no one's perfect, that means we need to be our brother's keepers. We need to be about our brothers and our sisters' businesses, aren't we? You want answered prayers? Make something happen for someone else, and God will make it happen for you. You ever heard that before? If you heard it before, why aren't we doing it? Why aren't we doing it? It's so simple. Let me make it happen for you and for you and for you and for you and for you. And then I start seeing it happening for me. And this is what it's all about. It's all about, you know what Bishop always says? Well, Pastor Tony always says, people touching people, touching people, touching people. But where are you being touched? Who was the last one that came to you and was concerned about you? Who was the last one that came to you and asked you how you were feeling last week when you didn't make it to church? We got to start changing the way we do things. It's not something that you come in here just for what you could get. You need to come here for what you can give. And as you start to give, you're going to start to receive. You know what? It's a giving and receiving. It's a giving and a receiving. When I write my tithe check out, when I give out my offering, when I give out my blessing, when I give out to the building fund, when I give out to whatever it is, I don't start to worry and start to allow the enemy to come in and start telling me, oh, you know what? Maybe they're not using that money for that. Or maybe they're not using that money for this. You got to be blind if you're not seeing what's going on in the lighthouse. It's all about people. It's all about people. It's all about people. It's all about serving. It's all about blessing. It's all about being a brother's keeper. If you come in hungry, we're going to feed you. If you come in hurting, we're going to minister to you. The money you're giving to the church is not for them to beg you. It's something that's your right in Christ Jesus to take your seed and sow it in the ground and test God in it and start to see the harvest start to come back. And when you see the harvest, how it starts to grow, and you start wondering, oh, my God, I never had it like this before. I'm telling you because I'm living that right now. And if I'm living it, I mean, brothers and sisters, all of us should be. I'm not scared to tithe. I'm not scared to bless. I'm not scared to give. And I'm not telling you that to press you guys that somebody told me to tell you. We don't talk about what we're going to say when we get up here. You know why? It's the Lord that ministers to us to minister to you. I didn't come with no pre-planned deal that I sit with Bishop and he tells me, oh, pray for James and pray for Sarah and this brother's going through this and that sister's going for that. No. I ask the Lord to download something in my heart that I could be able to speak a word in due season to my brothers and sisters that they can grow in the things of God. I come to challenge you tonight to change the way we do business in the church, in your lives. So many of you right now should be so prosperous, but you allow the fear to stop you from ever getting to where God had intended for you. There's so many business owners in this building right now that don't have a business because they're not willing to take a step and try God and allow God to work in it. If you fail one, get up, wipe yourself off, and go again. If you fail again, wipe yourself off, get up, and go again. You keep going until it happens for you. You think God wants you begging? I never seen no Christian begging for bread. You got to take some chances sometimes. If you can't sow it in the natural, sow it in the spirit and let somebody else be blessed. See, that's hard for me to say to you guys because some of you guys wouldn't believe that's true. I'm going to be real honest. I think some people here don't believe that. If you can't make it happen for you, make it happen for someone else. You know why? When you make it happen for someone else, God's going to make it happen for you. That sometimes you're being tested in what you're going through and what you're doing in your life. So watch what you're doing. God wants to answer your prayers. God is a God that's sovereign. He's a God that loves you. He's a God that wakes you up every day and says, you know, my child, I died like this. And you know what? I don't care what you did in your life. I'll elevate you. I'll make you, a man that I could take into the lighthouse and that could take over for me in this area and take care of the men that I'm going to send to you, the men that are all messed up. Maybe you can help me get them together, and I'm going to anoint you, and I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to bless your family, and I don't even want you to worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink. I don't care. I don't even want you to worry about where you're going to sleep. Did that happen for you?
Yes, sir.
Oh, it did? Yes. Did everybody hear that? Did that happen for you?
Yes, sir.
Now, hold on. Let me put my mic
Yes,
up.
Sir.
Ho, 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 ho. So I'm not talking out of the side of my neck, and I'm not talking about something that's not being experienced. I'm talking about things that are really happening. There was a barber that came to this church that graduated from this church. And the Lord took this man and used this man and blessed this man and brought this man back so that he could give back a portion of the blessing that he received. And the man tried his business out here. Maybe it didn't work the way he wanted it to. But you know what? Did he give up? Are you still a barber? Are you still blessed?
Yes, sir.
What?
Yes, sir.
You are blessed?
Yes, sir.
Oh. 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 This is proven statistics, brothers and sisters. How many stories haven't you heard about the men and women that have been here in this ministry, just like each and every one of you, that have gone out and made it in life, and they come back here? What's that teacher from that's been here to minister to us that he took the men and destroyed the house that day when he brought the word? Yes. Oh, my God. This brother, he graduated from here, and the Lord used him with children, and he's a coach right now, I believe, right? Is that you know the one that came to the men's meeting? That after that he came here and he ministered here? He's something with the schools, over the schools.
Scott. Oh, Scott.
That guy. Yeah. This is a guy that, you know what, he came back. And he said, you know what? I'm not only going to bless the kids in the school that I ministered to, I'm going to come back to the church where I started, and I want to bless the church. And he said, and he spoke a word into the men. And I'm going to tell you, that man set the place on fire. You remember that day when he ministered? He set the place on fire. And Bishop asked him to come back. And what did he do here on the pulpit? He set the place on fire. This is a proven statistic. A man that went through all of what you did. What did I say to you men yesterday when we were together? What do I see in you guys? Tell me, what did I speak about? Somebody tell me something of anything I said. Come on.
A businessman.
How do I see you? I see you blessed. I see you as men of God. I see you as men that are raising up. And God is asking me to speak to you about what? About getting ready when we get 60 feet out that gate, that life becomes real for us to be ready to deal with what's going to happen when we get out that gate. Isn't that what I spoke to you about?
Yes, sir.
Didn't I speak to you about what you're getting trained up in the lighthouse in? Maybe you may be pushing a mower. Maybe you may be cutting a tree. Maybe you in the mess hall cooking dinners and whatever it is. You're getting trained up in an area that you're going to be able to go out in society and take charge over it. And you're complaining about, they got me mowing all day long. I got to cut 60 pounds of potatoes today. But you got a place to sleep. You got a place to stay. Come on. They feed you. They give you the word of God. They ask you to do some things because you know why? If you don't get broken, where are you going to be the next day? Right back where you was, right? Yeah. So there's some things you're going to have to do. It's a labor-intensive ministry. So what? So you know what? You make every day count. You make every day count. You find a way to turn your mess and your stress into a blessing. Isn't that what I said to you guys? Find a way in the midst of the storm to find the good in it. That's exactly what I told these men. When you're stressed out, when you're going through something, God wants to answer your prayers. Let me get to the first scripture. How about it? Maybe I get through one tonight. Romans 12:2. I'm sorry, brothers and sisters. Somebody has to come and speak realities, have to speak the truth. And I'm not saying that's not what's being spoken here. Don't get me wrong. Let's not take this out of context because that's not what I'm trying to say to you. That sometimes we got to remember some things. Some things got to be re-spoken about a few times so that we could get kick-started in those areas again sometimes. And in Romans 12:2, it speaks about be not conformed to this world. Before we go anywhere, I want to stop right there. I want to hang a nail on that one. Be not conformed to this world. Be not conformed to this world. What makes you get conformed to the world? The pretty clothes, the pretty car, the nice shoes, the nice house, the nice jewelry, and the flashy furniture, and all these things. That's what conforms you. Because you know what? It makes you feel good when you got all that stuff, right? Doesn't it make you feel good when you got all these things? Yes, sir. Come on, anybody that says no, you know that that's not true. Let's not be conformed to the things of this world, brothers and sisters. Let's be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Let's renew our minds every day. Let's every day challenge ourselves to be a better person. Let's challenge ourselves to pray in a different way. Let's challenge ourselves to lift up our wives and our children and our grandmothers that prayed for us all these years, and now they're sitting in a bed, and you got to sit there cleaning whatever it may be and fixing the bed and cooking for them, and they're no earthly good no more because they gave their life to you all their life, and now they're sitting in a bed, and it bothers you to have to go up and do whatever you got to do for them to make it through another day. I know so many people that are doing that with their mothers and their fathers and their relatives that let them go to homes because they don't want to deal with them. But those people gave their lives to you. They lived for you. They prayed for you. They nurtured you. They paid for your way to school. They paid for your car. They paid for the clothes you got on. But you got conformed to the world. And the world system doesn't teach you to have those type of values. The world system doesn't teach you about wanting to keep somebody else going after they gave their whole lives to you. I was telling my friends the other day, I'm going to use the other example. Excuse me for saying this, but I'm going to say it. I said, you know what? Me and my wife may not look like the way we look when we were 39 years ago when we got married. 39 years ago, we looked like two young bucks and love and life was so different. But you know what? Come hell or high water, no matter what happens in my life, this is my life right here. This is my everything. I go to the grave with this woman. She gave me the best days of her life, and I plan to give her the best days of my life. I made a decision that I ain't no turning back from. And some men need to hear this. You know why? Because it's too much wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, and it's all gone and it's all over with. I'm sorry for bringing that up, but I have to. I have to because you know what? It's a shame that 70% of marriages in churches, you can laugh, but you know what? 70% of church of marriages in church are in trouble right now. 70% of marriages are breaking up, are being lost, are going to the wayside because nobody's praying. We talk about answered prayer, but you know what? Where are those that are praying for the marriages? Where are those that will stand up on Sunday when we keep telling you there's prayer there was prayer here, one person will show up, there's prayer over there, two people will show up, and all these people that are here, we should have that place so packed out with people praying, with people wanting to see God's hand move, to see God's prayers being answered, for to see something happen for someone else. Hey, have any of you bothered to look at that wall and see the red A on it that says it's answered prayers? Has anybody took a moment to go over there and count how many prayers have been answered since one or two got together or three or five got together to pray for that wall and that now there's an A on it because the prayer has been answered? Has anyone bothered to do that? I don't come here to condemn nobody. I don't come to try to knock nobody down. I come try to make people open their eyes and see that, you know what? We need to change the way we're doing business in the church today, brothers and sisters. If we want to see the hand move of God move. Listen, I'm tired of being told that revival is coming. I'm tired of people. I'm just sick and tired of people telling me that revival is on the way. We're days away. We're months away. We're years away. Well, revival is coming. Revival's not going to come until people start getting up and start doing what they need to do. Until they don't start praying together and starting to see their land being healed. Until they don't start to stand up and start taking those kids that are running around and being killed out there because we've allowed the schools to lose the privilege of having God in the school and having God in the courthouse and having God in all the places that he needs to be. And now these kids are running around crazy and getting killed and getting shot, and we're blaming everybody but ourselves. Everybody but ourselves. Corinthians 10:5 speaks about casting down imaginations. Let's start to cast down some things. Let's start to let go of some things. Let's start to let go and let God be in control of the things in our lives once again. Let's start to raise up a standard wherever they call us to be, in Walmart, in the job, in the home, in front of our children. Start to let them see you on bended knee again, asking for prayer again. And praying for them every day, and take a certain time of the day where they can see you on bended knee and ask them, invite them, would you like to pray with me again? Would you like to pray with me here today? Because the family that prays together stays together. It's a proven statistic. I'm not telling you something that's not true. The family that prays together stays together. And that's why there's so many broken families today. And they're not seeing the answers that they're looking for. They're praying about everything in the world, but they're not seeing the answers because they're not going about it in the right way. Do you think the God that we serve doesn't want to answer your prayers? Do we really believe that in this house?
No.
Is there anyone that really believes that? You don't. You may have prayed and maybe you didn't get the answer just when you want it. But you know what? It doesn't mean it's forgotten. It doesn't mean you're not going to receive it. It's just that we got to learn to be patient. We got to learn to endure a good fight. God wants to see how you handle some situations. I was with a brother today that owns a business that he's been in business for a few years now. His name is Juan. And this man's business never seems to prosper, never seems to really get off its feet. And it's not that the man doesn't do the right thing. The man, he'll do a job for you for $10, for $20, for $50, where you go to a mechanic and they'll do a job for $200, but they'll get two jobs to do in a day. He'll do five $20 jobs and get $100 and go home happy. And you know why? Because he knows, like he was telling me today, I know I blessed somebody today. I know I blessed somebody today. And you know what I tell him? I said, brother, I don't know how it looks like to you. I could tell you in the natural, it may seem the way it seems, but you know what? You're getting crowns built up for you. You're blessing the people of God because this is a man of God. This is a man that helps so many people in his church, and they come to him, and sometimes they think they're using and abusing him, but really, he's blessed by getting the $10 and the $20. He was telling me today, you know what? I do a $500 job for $100, and maybe I'll do two $100 jobs in a day, and I made $200. I could have made $1,000 if I was so worried about making the money, but you know what? I went home happy from getting the $200. And now I get all these little jobs that keep coming to me, and now I'm starting to see the hand of God moving in my life. Now he opened up a little dealer on 50th Street right off of Riverview. I come to tell you guys, God wants to bless you, man. God wants you to prosper in your jobs and in your families and in your children. But you know what? Until the praying moms don't come back and the praying dads and the ones that love, you know, unconditionally. And you know, well, my brother's son robbed me 10 times. You know, I just can't stand the kid anymore. No. Why don't you pray for the Lord to transform his life? Why don't you pray that the Lord's hand would come over him and that it would transform his life in a mighty way? Why don't you pray that the Lord would give him a job that would supply all his needs according to his riches and glory? Why don't you pray that the Lord would illuminate him and wake him up and call him into the kingdom? No, I can't stand the kid. I just can't be around him. All he does is rob me every time he comes. It's a shame, but it's reality, brothers and sisters. This is what I hear in my own ears in conversations I have with people out there. And then we say, we have answered prayer. You know what? There's a lot of people that could be way more blessed in this room than they are right now. I mean, some of you guys are doing really great. I'm telling you that now it's time to take it and superimpose it into a greater blessing. It's time to take it to another level. It's time to see things differently the way God is seeing it. Stop getting so emotional about things that happen to you and start to pray that the Lord will move on those situations. And when you start to see the answers of those prayers, you're going to start to see the answers for the situations that you've been going through in your life, because God is going to say, now I'm going to open the floodgates of heaven over your life. You want the floodgates? Pray them over somebody. Pray it over somebody. Look at somebody on your left. Look at somebody on your right tonight. And I right now want to challenge everyone in this room to look at somebody in this room. You don't have to let them know who it is, but I want you to pray for somebody in this room tonight. I don't care if you don't know the name. You say, Lord, that lady that sits in the fifth row in the seventh seat, that man that sits in the third row in the third seat, whatever it is, the Lord knows who you're praying for. And for this next 1 week, I want to challenge each and every one of you to lift somebody up in this room. And if they're not in this room, lift them up as well. Because this room should be so full that we should be in overflow every week. Because what we do for this community, what we do for these people, should have this place so packed out that we shouldn't even have parking to be able to park the cars. People should be in the street having encounters with God in the parking lot before they even get to the sanctuary. That's never going to happen if we don't start praying, brothers and sisters. It's never going to happen if we don't start lifting people up. And we don't start showing God that, Lord, I want to prepare a place that you can come, that you can live, that you can dwell and have your being in. If I'm going to cut somebody's head, they ain't going to even know I'm lifting them up. As I'm cutting their hair off, I'm going to be sitting there praying over them, over their family, over the blessing that God, you sent this one to me. And Lord, I want to bless him before he leaves this chair, Lord. I want to push that mower and I'm going to bless every strand of grass that I cut. I'm going to say, Lord, I'm doing this for your glory, Lord God. I want this place to look like a place, Lord God, where you would come, where you would move, Lord God, where people would come and say, wow, look what the Lord has done in this ministry.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This should be a place of excellence, a place that you don't see a paper on the floor because one of the loved ones would see it. They'll quickly run to grab it and pick it up. A place that when there's a need, everybody would run. Hey, let me. How many books we need for the women? We need 10 books. There should be 100 people getting up to say, I'll buy 10 books. You go to Walmart and you spend $50 on junk when you went there just to buy a bread for $2. And you know what? The other $48 you threw away, why don't you come and buy the 10 books for those women that would take them to another level? It's funny, but it's true. It's funny, but it's true. When was the last time on a Sunday you said to somebody here, you know what? Maybe I don't know you, but you know what? The Lord has blessed me this week, and I'd like to take you to McDonald's. I don't care if I could buy you a $2 cheeseburger and an order of French fries. It's just that I took the 5 minutes to sit with you and speak with you that I know that's going to do marvelous things. Everybody thinks you got to buy a steak dinner to be able to impress somebody, to let them feel like, oh, my God. Oh, I got to take my wife out, but I don't take my wife out because every time I go out, I spend $150. I take my wife to the park, and I buy a Publix sandwich, and we cut it in half, and I get a cup with ice, and we split it in half, and we're happy with it. Honey, don't we do that?
Yes.
We do. We do that. May sound crazy to you, but we do that. We take our dog, we bring a little plastic cup like this, right? With water in it. We take another plastic cup with a little bit of food for the dog because the dog can't come with me and we're not feed the dog. And while we're eating our sandwich, our dog is there. How about me? You know what I mean? Really? I think you guys went with us one time, didn't y'all? Didn't we do that? I'm not telling you things that I don't do myself. I go around this room in every service and I try to shake everybody's hand I possibly can. I try to shake everyone's hand in this sanctuary. Everybody should be doing that every time you walk in this building. You should be taking the time to shake somebody's hand, to show them the love of God, to show them that they're appreciated, that they're wanted in this building. Five more minutes. Is that all right, Pastor? Five more minutes. I'm going to keep the whipping stick out. Don't mind me, guys, but I got to, you know what I mean? I got to try to keep it going here. I'm going to change to page two, even though I said three words on page one. Anxieties and burdens. Anxiety and burdens are set up to be able to take you off track. Anxieties and burdens are made to keep you depressed and down and just not feeling like you should feel. That's right. And the only reason why you feel the pressure of anxiety and burdens in your life is because you're not taking charge. You're not sitting down before God and asking him, Lord, this thing I give to you. This cup, I pass it to you. I choose not to carry this with me anymore, Lord. I choose to release it right here, right now to you, Lord God. And what do you think a God like the God we serve would say to you? Come on, someone tell me, what do you think the God that we serve would say to you? Come on.
It's already done.
It's already done. Huh. See, we start focusing too much on the things we don't need to focus on instead of focusing on the things that's really going to bring change, the things that are really going to make you be the Christian that God wanted you to be, being blessed. And you know what? Every time you get up and you pray, you know that something's going to happen. And you know what? It may not have happened that moment, but you know what? I know that the Lord that I serve is going to answer that petition. And you know what? Sometimes you may still have the symptoms, and you know what? You were healed, but you know what? You lose the blessing because you walk away saying, well, I'm still the same way I came. Really, this is what happens in church today. Instead of thanking God for what happened that moment, that you know what, that man released his faith over you, that woman released her faith over you, and that she believed that me, you, and God came together, and when three or more together, what happens? Come on, when three come together, what happens? So do you think that you walked away like this because the God that you served didn't answer you? I'm sorry, guys. Mark 11:24. Whoever has it, come on, somebody say it out loud. Mark 11:24. Can you say that again? Stop right there. Believe you have what? Believe you have what? Believe that 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 you have what? Yes, there it is. There it is. You have to believe that you received it. See, there's a lot of people that they don't believe that they receive it. And that's why they're not blessed right now. And that's why they're going through stuff, Pastor. And that's why you got to come week in and week out and tell them the same thing over and over again in a different way. Until they receive it, until they understand it, until they grasp it. And they start to run with it. And they start to live it out. You know that answered prayer glorifies God? How many know that answered prayer glorifies God? Oh, yeah. Everyone in this room should be lifting up their hands. If there's someone in this room that ain't lifting them up, that means you ain't asking for prayer. Everybody's hand should be up right there. God is glorified when he answers your prayers. God is blessed when he answers your prayers. Philippians 4:6. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and what? And with what? And let your request be what? Hold on. Let's say that again. I think I read this backwards or something. There's something I didn't get here. Let me do this again. Be anxious for what?
Nothing.
But in everything what? And what? With what? Let your request be what? Oh, we got to let our request be known to God. We got to let our request be known to God. You need to let your request be known to God. Don't complain. Don't murmur. Don't let things all rile you up. Let your petitions be known to God. Walk around this place being what God has called you to be. Blessed men of God. Men that are being reconstructed. Men that are getting ready to take the world by force. Men that are getting ready to take their rightful position. Women that are getting ready to take back their families. Women that are getting ready to be blessed. Women that are getting ready to be used. Women that are going to be paid more than men. You know why I can say that? Because, man, when I see what my wife has done for my kids and for me, listen, I wish she makes double for her trouble. I pray she gets double for her trouble. These women, they labor day in, day out. They get, what did I say to you, man, yesterday? Some situations we left behind. Some women are in situations right now that are dire situations, that never knew how to be on their own, that don't know what to do while you're here in the program, and God is ministering to you, and God is blessing you, and you're complaining about your time that you're here instead of understanding that God got you under reconstruction, and there's a woman that's out there that's hurting, that don't know what to do, that's turning around looking for help everywhere they can go. This is the reality. There's men with children that have to be the father for the first time in their lives because they never understood what it's to be without the mother being present all the time. And now they got to be mommy and daddy, and they got to provide, and they got to work. And I'm telling you, God answers your prayers. God wrote each and every name of each and every person in this building. I said it before when I ministered here before. Every name that has ever gone through the lighthouse was 63 years ago when her father, when her father was driving by, and her father seen the light that the Lord illuminated that man, and the Lord said to him, "This is the place. This is the place. This is where I want you to be. This is where I want you to build. This is where I want you to construct." Because you know what? There's people, even that before they were even born, that their names were written on this land, and they're going to have to pass through here one day. Hallelujah. Each and every one of your names is written on the tabernacles of this building. Each and every one of your names was written out plainly by God, even before some of you were born. You had to come through the lighthouse. It's an answered prayer for God. He prayed it, he thought it, and he made it happen. And he wants to do the same for each and every one of you. Wow. I don't want you to leave this building without understanding. He wants to do it for each and every one of you. Yes. Yes. He wants to answer your prayer. He wants to be your God. He wants to be your supplier. He wants you to have a cup that runneth over so that you would able to be able to give unto others and bless other people's lives. And that you will be a man and a woman of prayer. When you see something happening, the first thing that you would do is start to intercede. Yeah. Every time you have a moment to touch a shoulder, to touch a person, to walk by somebody and bump into them, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, you know what's going on there, Lord. You know the need, Lord God. Hallelujah. Give him your petitions, and he'll give you your peace. Amen.